Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Bethany today. It's a beautiful, brisk morning out here. Feels great. Well, sort of great. So I just want to review a few announcements with you that you hear every week, but let's review them again so that we can remember what opportunities we have to be together this week. So this morning we're having Pastor Luke here, which is a blessing. He's from New Life Bridgeport. And then there's going to be a Studio Biblico in the yard here after service at 11:30. And on Monday, you have the opportunity to be on a Zoom call, have prayer and fellowship with Rachel. And I know Linda's on that call, so please join that call so you can be, if you have the opportunity to do it during the week, so that you can be fellowshipping, since we have less times to do that now. Take the opportunities that we do have. That's on Monday. And then on Wednesday, we're doing another outdoor socially distanced Awana for the kids that are willing to participate between 6 and 7. It's a short one. So those that have kids, that they'll wear masks and everything and be distanced, but we're gonna meet as long as we can outside before the weather turns. That's on Wednesday, and then Thursday is our normal other prayer and fellowship Zoom call in the evening at 7 p.m. So please join us for that. Excuse me. And then next week we have the Park Bridgeport pastor speaking, Pastor Kenson Lamb. So we have some exciting people to hear and listen to this week and next. And now Dave is going to lead us in Psalm 126.
Good morning. We'll be reading from Psalms 126 this morning. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping, bearing a seed of sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. And now, Mr. Cruz.
Salmos 126. Cuando el Señor hizo volver a Sirón a los cautivos, nos parecía estar soñando. Nuestra boca se llenó de risas, nuestra lengua de canciones jubilosas. Hasta los otros pueblos decían, el Señor ha hecho grandes cosas por ellos. Sí, el Señor ha hecho grandes cosas por nosotros, y eso nos llena de alegría. Ahora, Señor, haz volver a nuestros cautivos como haces volver los arroyos del desierto. El que con lágrimas siembra, con regocijo cosecha. El que llorando esparce la semilla, cantando recoge sus gravillas. Salmo 126.
Let's pray. Thank you, God, for this morning. Thank you for this beautiful day that we can gather outside and enjoy seeing the sky, seeing the trees, and being together, Lord, even in the middle of the hard circumstances. But we want to worship you, Lord, and thank you for this chance that you're giving us. Please prepare our hearts, clean our hearts from sin, forgives us, and allowed us to feel and understand that forgiveness that comes through Jesus Christ, so we can be able to worship you this morning, Lord. I pray for the sermon as well, as Pastor Luke is preaching this morning, that you will use him to speak to us. Also prepare our hearts so we can be able to listen to the word, listen to your voice in this sound, Lord. And thank you for giving us freedom and giving us the time and the willingness to do so. We love you, Lord, and we ask for your Holy Spirit this morning to be filling us, to put at work the gifts and talents you've been giving us. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Talk about the faithfulness of God. We are unfaithful, but He is faithful, and we depend on his faithfulness and not in our own. Pastor Luke is pastor of New Life, and he's going to be speaking today the word. So I want to invite Pastor Luke and invite you to pay attention and listen to the word as the Lord is speaking today.
Good morning, Bethany.
Good morning.
I get to take my uniform off now to talk to you guys. I don't have a good habit of remembering my uniform, but I'm getting better at that. So, well, I want to greet, in the name of Jesus, the McKinley Park neighborhood. It's great to be here. And I rode my bike over from another outdoor service. New Life was getting started outside. And as I rode down 35th Street, I rode by Park Community doing their outdoor service right there by Trip Light. They're able to use the Trip Light green space. And so I didn't stop and say hi to them. I was just driving by. I want to be safe. So glad to be with you today. And like we have a habit of saying, your smiling eyes are beautiful, okay? Your smiling eyes are beautiful. Today I come with greetings from our church and the larger, I just want to encourage you in the Lord today. And I want to take a different approach at that. I wanted to share with you something that God's been speaking to me. And he gave me this just through my personal time with him. And how many of you know there's sometimes when you're doing your regular Bible reading, now I hope you have a regular Bible reading, and you read a passage and you think on it, you pray on it for that day, and the next day you come back and God says, do that one again. Do that passage again. And I said, well, I already read that one, Lord. He's like, I got more for you there. And so I read that again. And I read this passage again. And I use a journal to try to capture what God is teaching me. That's one way that God has helped me over the years. And I've got 3+ days of journals with this psalm. Now, I'm not going to read those for you. But I want you to know that what I'm sharing today is born out of personal experience, what God is teaching me. And I believe, I have faith, because God's word never comes back empty. Amen? That when God's word is proclaimed with the help of his Holy Spirit, it produces a good fruit in the life of those who hear it with a good heart. And so, as Josue has prayed, that we would listen, that we would hear, and my prayer is that this will bless you and encourage you as individuals, but more than that, as a church family together. And so, let's talk about where we're at in 2020. Before I kind of dive in. 2020, what a year. How many of you say my favorite year ever, 2020? Anybody? All right. Well, okay, see, there's some. Not all terrible things happened in 20. I was just at a wedding yesterday, and for that couple, 2020 is a great year. There are many good things that come out of 2020. I had a pastor friend, and he said, well, you know what, Luke? When I was thinking about the Bible, a lot of the stories that we see in the Old Testament and even in the book of Acts, the reason it made the Bible was because it was a really terrible time. It was a catastrophe. It was a calamity. There was this enemy army, countless numbers that were coming to attack the nation of Israel. And so it made the Bible. It was a really bad year, and it made the Bible. God shows up in the midst of really bad. God shows up. And so we started 2020 hearing about this virus. And then in March, the quarantine started, kind of a lockdown. I've been thinking, those were really hard weeks. All of us just kind of saying, what's happening? How serious is it? How bad will it be? And then through the summer, seeing different parts of the nation where it swept through, and here we are, September 20th. Did we ever imagine that we would still be in the midst of this? Now, maybe some of you said, yeah, when they say pandemic and they say worldwide, I knew it was going to take several months. I think I heard that and didn't want to believe it. So I'm a little sad that we're still here, to be honest with you. And then in the midst of a pandemic, we have social unrest. We have issues of racism coming up in our country, and I love the police, and yet there are areas where the police need to grow and change, and protests and riots and looting, and all kinds of things that can break your heart. And now in the West, there's wildfires and natural disasters, and you guys are saying, Luke, we live here. We understand. You don't need to tell us everything that's going on. I'm sorry. Why am I painting this picture? Why am I reminding you of all the rough things that have happened in 2020? Because I want you to understand the first word of this psalm today. When. when. Psalm 126 is a psalm about remembering what God has done in a really terrible year. And how he, actually 70 years, and how he brought back his people to himself. And now this psalm is remembering that terrible time, God restoring his people, and then praying, God, would you do it again? God, would you restore your people again? Would you show yourself powerful, merciful, kind again? And Lord, we're going to do the promise and the principle that you give us. We're going to believe the promise. We're going to follow the principle that you give us. So let me pray, and then we'll dive into the context and then make our application for today. God, thank you for this time, this privilege to be here. Thank you for a beautiful day. We commit to you this time now as our Bibles are open. And I pray that not just our Bibles would be open, God, but our minds, our hearts, and that the seed of this word would fall on good soil. Lord, right now, if there's any in this hearing that are burdened down with worry, with anxiety, that they would give that to you and they would receive your peace in exchange. Those of us who have health issues, God, that we're concerned about, we give you our health. Those of us who have relationship problems that we can't seem to get through, we give you our relationships. Those of us who are just discouraged and maybe isolated, feeling lonely and depressed, God, we look to you and we say, give us your light today. Lift our eyes to the hills where our help comes from. It comes from you, the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Oh Lord, lift hearts, lift spirits today through the preaching of your word. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to be reading from the New American Standard Version. It's very similar to what was read. I'll tell you why I chose it as we go along. Look at verse 1 of Psalm 126. When the Lord restored our fortunes, or New American Standard, when the Lord brought back the captives to Zion. That word about bring back, literally it means bring back the returning ones. And so this phrase is talking about a historical moment in the life of the nation of Israel. When, remember with me, in the Old Testament, God made a covenant with his people. If you follow me, trust me, obey my law, I will protect you, I'll protect this land, I will prosper it, and through you salvation will come to all the earth. However, if you do not keep my covenant with you, if you don't trust me with your whole heart, love me, therefore obey my law and keep my commands, if you don't, then I will actually allow the nations around you to turn against you, and I will be not on your team, but on their team. And I will bring you into captivity. And so in 586 BC, the Babylonians came and conquered the city of Jerusalem and that southern nation called Judah. They invaded the city of Jerusalem. They burned down the city dwellings. They destroyed the temple. They captured and carried off the best and brightest people, young people like Daniel and the three of his friends, to serve under the king of Babylon and to make Babylon great. Think about that. I'm an Israeli young man, but now the Babylonians have come and taken us captive, and now I'm called to serve their king and to benefit their kingdom. This was in fulfillment of God's promise to his people. If you don't keep the covenant, I will allow this to happen so that it will be a wake-up call to you that I need your heart, I need your faith, and I need your obedience. I need you to listen to my prophets, to my word. And then, if you don't, your enemies will come and overtake you. What a tragedy. What a devastation. What a loss of life. There were battles at this time. There was a siege of Jerusalem. Lamentations tells us about it. It got so bad that people were eating their own children before the Babylonians finally conquered. What a loss of future plans, dreams. Let me tell you that wars and military takeovers and slavery are traumatic. And any life-altering situation, it can change us for years and years to come. And we need to recognize that as we go through the trials of 2020, that we are all dealing with these things in different ways, and we need to care for one another, love for one another deeply, so that the marks of 2020 don't leave lasting scars in our lives. Let's take one another to the Lord for healing and for encouragement and for support. But this, what they went through in 586 BC, is nothing like what we're living in 2020. We got it pretty easy, folks, compared to being overrun by a military power, being put under siege. And so they went off to Babylon. And 70 years later, it was prophesied by Jeremiah the prophet. It was remembered and it was prayed for by Daniel the prophet. The exiled people of Israel, do you remember this? They were miraculously allowed to go back to their country. The king of Persia not only allowed them to go, but he sponsored their travel. He protected their travel. He funded the rebuilding of the temple and the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem. This is amazing. Under Ezra, the temple was rebuilt. Under Nehemiah, the walls of Jerusalem were rebuilt. God began rebuilding the lives of his people. Look at verse 1 again. When the Lord brought back the captives to Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Other versions say when the Lord restored the fortunes, when he brought back the captives, our greatest joy came to be a reality. Our dream became real. God gave us victory over sadness. He restored the things we had lost. But imagine how long that process was. If I was 10 when the Babylonians came and I was taken to Babylon, I have grown up hearing the stories about Jerusalem, about the temple, about the sacrifices, the music of the Levites. But I had to live away. I married, I had kids, and I taught them the stories of Jerusalem and the temple and the Levites. And I always dreamed, could we go back someday? And now when I'm 80 years old, I hear that the Persian king is sending us back to Zion. Oh, I'm gonna make that trip. You can put me on a donkey and whatever you need to do, but I'm going back to Jerusalem. Oh, what a joy. Oh, what a dream fulfilled. When the Lord brought back the captives to Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Have you been dreaming during 2020? Have you been asking God, God, would you restore us to what it used to be? I hope you have. I know for me, when life is so hard day after day, it just feels like I just go outside and I get beat up by the news. I get beat up by another story, by another natural disaster, by another political mess, by another tragic story of violence or racism or injustice. But I need to dream. And I want to encourage you to dream. What is it that you're asking God to do to restore in your life and to maybe even bring you back to a place of deeper communion with him than you had before? We were like those who dream, the word says. And then it says in verse 2, then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue was filled with joyful shouting. And they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad. Today, I want you to see this psalm just in three sections. Number one, a praise. Praise for what God has done. Number two, a prayer. We're going to ask God, would you do something? And then a promise and a principle. So verses 1-3, here's the praise. The Lord who does great things has restored his people back to himself and filled them with joy. This is what we need to remember about God, that when he allows his people to go through a time of suffering, there will be restoration. I can say that with confidence. Your restoration may not happen in this world. But you will be restored to God. You will be brought through your time of suffering, and you will be in His presence. There is fullness of joy. Amen? And so if He doesn't do it in this world, He will do it ultimately, and we can trust that God will restore the fortunes. He will restore the joy of His people. And notice what it says, that God filled our mouths with laughter and our tongue with shouting. Isn't it good to get together with people and just laugh? I get together with pastor friends on a regular basis, and not so much lately, just to be honest with you, but there are some times when we all just need to laugh, and so somebody's cracking a joke, and I laugh so hard that my eyes water, like I'm crying in laughter. I really want to laugh like that again real soon. Anybody with me? Have you had a good hard laughter like that? God loves it when His people laugh at the right things. He wants to fill our hearts with joy. And we can ask Him for it. He's done it in the past. That's what it says. And He wants to do it again. And so our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with joyful singing. This is a party. It's a celebration. It's the rain that came after the time of drought. It's the end of a war that everyone's been fighting and sacrificing for. When the captives came back, our mouths were filled with laughter. And then it says, when God restores, that other people see what God is doing. The nation said, the Lord has done great things for them. When you're walking with the Lord, even through times of trial, and you trust Him, and He brings you through, you give glory to God, and the people around you say, wow, God does great things for you. Your God really works for you. Now, I understand when He doesn't follow through or He doesn't do what you want Him to do in your timetable, sometimes people scoff and they say, where is your God now? Well, you can hang on. But trust that when God does reveal Himself and when God does give you the victory, the nations will see it. It's a time of witness. Giving God praise is a form of witness to the world. God has done great things for us. We are glad. I love verse 3. The nations say it, and then we say it. The nations recognize it. God has done great things for them. And then we say, God has done great things for us. And we are glad. I want to encourage you today as we remember the praise that God is owed. Remember what He's done in the past, and let that encourage you today that He's still working in your life today. What He's done in the past, He is able to do in the present and the future. So we can trust Him and we can praise Him even before we have it in hand. Amen? Now the prayer. Look at verse 4. We don't just praise God, but we turn and we say, God, restore our fortunes, or NASB, restore our captivity, Lord. As the streams in the Negev, or the streams in the southern part. The Negev was a desert. The southern part of the land of Israel, the Negev desert. And so they're saying, God, would you restore us and give us a stream in the middle of a desert? I think to myself, deserts don't normally have streams. Deserts are dry and barren and hot. But if you put a stream in the desert, you're going to bring things to life. I love the ask here. Restore our fortune. Bring back our captives. If we could put it another way, God, would you bring back the things that should be here that aren't right now? God, would you bring back the people who are not yet in your fold? Bring them to you. Or Lord, bring back those people who've been taken away, maybe prodigals, people who've drifted away from you, people who have lost interest in you, people who've been worn out by the world and the struggles that they face. God, would you bring them back to you? And Lord, the people who Satan has been messing with, he's stolen away, he's discouraged, he's lied to, he's deceived, he's hurt them. Bring them back, Lord. They are your people. You have good plans for them. They're our loved ones, God, people we care about. And you want to receive glory through their lives. And so, Lord, bring them back. Heal relationships. Bring life to what is dead. Bring joy to what is discouraged. Bring laughter to what is so serious and heavy. Lord, bring redemption to your people. And Lord, do it like a stream in the middle of a desert. Places that are currently hard and dry, you can't stay there long or you'll die. God, would you bring a stream, bring water and life and new plants and shelter and new fruit and laughter again? That's the prayer. God, restore our fortunes, restore our captives back to you. So that's the ask. That's what, because God has restored in the past, we're asking him, would you restore us again? And now look at the principle, and this is where we get application, and this is where God kept bringing me back. Verse 5 and 6, those who sow in tears shall reap with joyful shouting. Those who go to and fro weeping, carrying his bag of seed, shall indeed come again with a shout of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. Here's the promise or the principle. Even when we have to sow with tears, God will bring reaping with joy. Even when we have to sow with tears, God will bring reaping with joy. You're saying, Pastor Luke, you seem like a nice guy. I have no idea what you're talking about. What is sowing and reaping? I don't have needles and thread. We don't do that. We go to Target and buy clothes, okay? All right, let's break this down. Verse 5. Those who sow in tears. Sowing means planting seeds. This is a farming illustration. It's an agriculture illustration. And again, I know where I live. We're city people. We're not that great at farming. Now, some of us probably do okay. Maybe some of you, I haven't asked you, how are your tomatoes doing, right? You got peppers coming still? Anybody? All right. I had raspberries, but they were done a long time ago. They were very good. I counted each and every one, okay? Sowing is the idea of taking initiative to plant a seed with the belief that this seed has the potential of life in it, and I believe it will grow and produce life and fruit. Sowing is saying, I'm going to put something in the ground and let God's natural order of things take over. And God will work with the seed that I planted and cause it to grow. This is what we're talking about when we talk about sowing. And reaping has to do with harvesting. Reaping is what you do after the seed has gone through its life cycle. It has grown into a plant. It has produced branches and blossoms and whatever kind of fruit or vegetable you have. And reaping is going out to see what God has done since you planted the seed. And he's brought a beautiful new gift of life from your sowing. And you bring it in, and you rejoice. And if you're like Luke, you get to count every raspberry. And you celebrate, God has brought life from the seed that I sowed. This is what we're talking about in these verses. This is the promise and a principle. The promise is that God, if you go out sowing, even in tears, he will bring you back reaping in joy. But we gotta look at this. Verse 5, those who sow in tears. Now, I gotta be honest with you, I don't usually sow in tears. When I deal with my raspberry, I'm not crying. I actually enjoy it. It's my hobby. I have fun sowing my raspberries, taking care of them, pulling up the weeds, pruning it every year so that the new will grow. But I'm not crying. I'm happy about it. This is a fun thing. What are we talking about sowing in tears? We're talking about there are times in our lives, like the year 2020, when life is simply hard. And following Jesus is harder than it has been in the past. and everything that you used to do might take extra effort. It might take extra initiative. You don't feel like doing the things you used to do. It's hard to get together. Look what we're doing. We kind of get to, have to, meet outside. Now, this is not bad. We're not suffering to do this. But I think those of you who served and put this together, it's maybe a little extra work, isn't it? And thank you, worship team. Thank you, tech people, for setting this up. Thank you for doing live stream. Thank you for all your labor. It's harder. Following Jesus is hard. And sometimes it's harder than normal hard. And so sometimes we have to sow in tears. But notice what it says is that verse 6, he who goes, in my version, to and fro, or goes out sowing, goes out weeping, but with seeds to sow. There has to be initiative taken. Your seed does no good in your hand. Your seed doesn't do good in the package and in your shed or on your back porch. Seed has to be taken out and planted where it could grow. And so this verse and the principle of this verse says that God is faithful to bring a harvest to people who take initiative to plant seeds. Even when you're crying about it. Even when life is hard. Even when you have to weep in your sowing. We have to take initiative. We have to step out in faith. We have to put our trust of God into action. Just like James chapter 2. Faith without deeds is dead. Useless, empty, in vain. I can't say, God, I just trust you. I just trust you. I just trust you. And not obey God's word. And not take initiative toward the things of God. That's not faith. We believe God, therefore we act and we obey and we will take initiative. Biblical truth is not meant to reside simply in our minds. It's not simply meant to be proclaimed on a Sunday. Biblical truth, this book, is meant to be opened and the seed of it is meant to be planted in your life, and then you take it and you go out and plant it through the way that you live and talk and serve and love and work. Those are seeds that you are planting for the glory of God. I'm talking about personal, spiritual initiative. Are you taking steps to plant the seeds that God gives you, even in times of weeping? What are some of these seeds? Let me give us some maybe more practical examples. Sowing seeds means in faith, though I don't feel like it, though it's hard, though I have excuses why I don't have to do it, in faith, I'm going to plant the seeds of motives and thoughts and actions that are pleasing to God. How do I do that? By renewing my mind with God's word every day. I believe that if I'm in God's word, he will cause me to grow. And then I can go obey God's word and he will cause those seeds to grow. There's seeds of gospel that we need to plant. We need to proclaim to the whole world, Jesus Christ loves you. Jesus Christ came to die in your place. Why? Because we humans are all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. We all deserve God's righteous judgment in hell. But Jesus came to rescue us from that. And if we would repent of our sin and turn to Christ, he will make us new. He will give us a new life, forgiveness, peace, a purpose. He'll fill us with his spirit and give us hope and direction for all of our days here and for all eternity elsewhere. God will make us new. This is the gospel seed. Are you planting it? Are you sowing it? Even when it's hard. I'm trying. I'm with you. There are many people on my mind I haven't talked to in several months. I haven't seen because my relationships are different. And I'm praying, Lord, they don't know you yet. They haven't trusted you yet. help me to sow the seed of the gospel in their life again. How about seeds of truth, that we build one another up with God's word? This is in the body of Christ. Are you speaking God's truth to one another? How about seeds of prayer? Although we can't come together the same way we used to, we can pray for each other. And then, with all our snazzy technology, we can text or call or email, and we can tell people, I just prayed for you. Ha, prayed for you. Love you, thinking about you, prayed for you. You know what, it's encouraging to get a text that says, I just prayed for you. Thank you, I need it every day. And so we can sow seeds of prayer. And then, boy, if you add on a scripture to that, that's just like a double seed, come on. Just put some truth in there too, to encourage people in their lives. How about seeds of kindness? Simple things. Hey, I was thinking of you, I was at the store. I know you like this kind of pop, I just picked it up. I left it on your porch. I know we can't see each other. Here it is. Oh, thank you. Seeds of kindness to those in the body of Christ and those neighbors around us. When we sow seeds of kindness, it softens the soil of the heart to receive the seed of the gospel. And so, even in times of tears, when it's hard, when it doesn't come natural or easy, Lord, help me to sow these seeds of obedience. And what's the promise? The end of verse 5, they shall reap with joyful shouting. And the end of verse 6, they shall indeed come again with a shout of joy, bringing sheaves with them. Indeed, it says in my version in verse 6, indeed, God doesn't play. He promises you will reap and you will have joy. Again, I can't promise you that it will happen tomorrow. I can't promise you it will happen next week, but I do promise you it will happen. There is nothing wasted. God rewards. Remember what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount? When you pray, go into the secret place. Go into your prayer closet, because God who sees what's done in secret, he will reward you. And so I want to encourage you, none of your seed sowing is wasted. You might say, that didn't do anything. Don't believe that for a minute. If it's a seed of the gospel, the seed of truth, the seed of kindness, the seed of prayer, and God is in it with his Holy Spirit, God is working. You can trust him. He'll bring a harvest. And it says that God will bring you back again with songs of joy and with these sheaves or this harvest in your hand. Bethany Baptist, although we are going through a time of weeping, and I'm here because we're kind of in a time of transition here at Bethany Baptist. That's another opportunity that's hard, isn't it? And I'm praying for you, and I'm here to help however I can. And New Life stands in support of you. We are your brothers and sisters, your family. We want to see the gospel continue to go forward through this local body. But it's a time of weeping. And I want to encourage you, don't stop sowing seeds of love, seeds of truth, seeds of gospel, seeds of prayer, seeds of hope. Don't stop it, even in times of weeping. Seeds of God's kingdom. He is working. He will save those whom he has called. God is faithful. Jesus said, I won't lose any of those that God draws. And so our job is to continue to proclaim the hope of new life in Jesus Christ, and then God's job is to save people. There is a group that wrote a song about this psalm, and the chorus just goes, although we are weeping, Lord, help us keep sowing the seeds of your kingdom, for the day you will reap them. Your sheaves we will carry. Lord, please do not tarry. All those who sow weeping will go out with songs of joy. Galatians 6, verse 9, Paul wrote, do not grow weary in doing good, for at the proper time you will reap a harvest if you do not give up. I feel led just to pray for us this morning and to pray for you as Bethany Baptist Church. So would you allow me to do that as we close? Father, I pray in these moments right now, as we acknowledge that this is a season of weeping, that you would meet us in this place. God, life has been hard in 2020. We've gone through many trials. We're still in them, Lord. We're not through this hard stretch. And yet, Lord, we know you're with us. We know you're faithful. And we thank you for this word from Psalm 126 that you have restored your people in the past. You brought back the captives from exile, and we rejoiced, and it was like a dream coming true. And now, Lord, we ask, would you do it again? Would you restore us, God? Would you draw us back to yourself? And not just us, God, but those who have wandered away, those who are not here, those who have taken a hit because of all the trials of 2020. Jesus, would you restore them? And God, we believe your principle and your promise that even in times of weeping, we will go out sowing your seed, the seed of the gospel, the seed of love, prayer, truth, hope. Oh, Holy Spirit, empower Bethany Baptist Church to keep sowing your seeds and believing, God. Fill them with fresh faith. Fill them with fresh hope. Give them dreams again about the future. And Lord, guide them. Lead them together in unity and in love. Give them your wisdom. Give them your counsel, God. Give them your creativity. Help them not to grow weary in doing good, because God, you will reap a harvest if they do not give up. Lord, you will bring them back with sheaves and songs of joy. Fill their mouths with laughter, God. Fill their tongues with songs of joy. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your word. It is life. It is truth. It is fresh water to our soul. Bring a new spring in this time of desert. And we, in advance, thank you for it. We pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.